Oh, I know. Looks pretty good, right? Man, free range, organic, premium roasted hot dog. No, Kessel, you can't have any. Because you're on bust watch. Welcome back to the Fantasy Hockey Podcast. It's time to talk about Phil Kessel. And yes, all hot dog jokes and everything aside, he's a good player. It's just, he's not putting it together this season. Now, of course, you can't forget that he went from an elite team in Pittsburgh to the Arizona Coyotes. And while the Coyotes are doing really well so far this season, it hasn't really been because of their offense. It's largely been because of their defense and their goaltending. Their shooting percentage is one of the worst in the league. I think they're 24th in the league at from a team-wide shooting percentage. And so they haven't been great at putting the puck in the back of the net, but they haven't for a few years now. So that's not what's changed. What's really changed is their goaltending is much more stable this year, and their defense is much, much better. So let's take a look at Phil Kessel and see what's happened in this season and if there's paths to him actually getting back to his old numbers. And I don't think there necessarily is. I'll preface with that. That he was an 82-point player last year. I don't think he gets there this year. I don't think that's who he is. I think we're definitely going to see a regression in points. The big question is, how much of a regression, and is that regression still worth it to you? So let's start first, of course, with Phil Kessel's deployment and take a look at where he's playing. So he's slated technically, according to Daily Faceoff, on the third line with Carl Soderberg and Lawson Kraus, which is not a great third line. Carl Soderberg, we know, is a very, very defensive player, very defensively responsible player. And so Phil Kessel is the lone offensive wolf on this line. It's almost like they have Lawson Kraus and Carl Soderberg on the ice to win the puck back, and then Phil Kessel jumps on the ice and they launch him into an attack. That's virtually how it's been played, in essence, because Carl Soderberg and Lawson Kraus are very defensive players. So Phil Kessel is, well, it's the one who stands out there. It's kind of a weird line, to be honest. I wouldn't expect that at all. And then if we look at the power play units, he's on the top power play unit with Clayton Keller, Derek Stepan, Christian Dvorak, and Oliver Ekman-Larsson. If we look at the last three games, even though that line is technically the third line, that line that he's on has seen the most minutes. At least from a consistency standpoint of who is stuck together the most, that Lawson Kraus, Phil Kessel, and Carl Soderberg line is the one who's gotten the most frequency over the last three games at 20.5%. There's a lot of kind of shifting on other lines, and so it's not necessarily that they got the most minutes, it's just they were the most consistent from a holding together standpoint. And from a Corsi 4 percentage standpoint, they were the second worst line. The worst line was the Brad Richardson, Michael Grabner, and Christian Fisher line. That's a pretty defensive line as well, though. I wouldn't expect them to really lead in Corsi 4, but you'd like to see better than 29.3% Corsi 4 percentage. The Phil Kessel line is only 33.3%, which is also really, really bad. They really don't control shot share. And that's bad for a guy like Phil Kessel, who's so offensive. Wouldn't you want Phil Kessel on the line that is the highest Corsi 4 percentage to try to figure it out where he's getting more shot attempts for while he's on the ice than against? You'd think, right? That would make the most sense. But at the same time, it kind of makes sense when you have a guy like Carl Soderberg and Lawson Kraus on your line that you're going to actually be more on the defensive side and you'd actually probably have slightly lower Corsi 4 percentage numbers. So why Phil Kessel's on that line beats me. And from a power play perspective, he's playing around 60 to 70% of the team's power play percentage, depending on any given night. That's normally where he's at. He's actually double shifted on some occasions. For the last three games, 38.7% of the frequency has been Christian Dvorak, Clayton Keller, Phil Kessel, and Derek Stepan. The other 29% of his time on the power play that we can see, at least on Frozen Pool, was Connor Garland, Phil Kessel, Nick Schmaltz, and Carl Soderberg. Those are two very different power plays. So either, honestly, I haven't completely paid attention to where he's been shifting around there, but that either means that he double shifted, which is likely, or that he just featured on both at different times throughout the last three games. So now that we know his deployment, which honestly isn't that bad, aside from his even strength, I really don't like his even strength line, his power play deployment is actually really, really good. Let's take a look at the in-season tool. So his minutes are pretty much the same as last year. So remember, he complained a little bit about minutes, and now he's playing just to kind of around the same, which is disappointing, I would say, if I'm Phil Kessel. So he's sitting at around 18 minutes a game, not too different from last year. It was almost exactly the same. What has changed a lot is his point pace. Last year, he had 82 points. Right now, he's currently on a 46-point pace. Now, what has gone wrong for Phil Kessel so far for the people that don't own him or for people that do and maybe don't understand what's going on? There's a few things. One, his shot pace is the same. So his shot pace is fine. He's shooting the same as last year. But what has changed a lot is his shooting percentage. Last year, he shot at 12.5%. Right now on the season, he's sitting at only 5%. They've played 23 games so far, but over the last 15 games, he's only shot at 2.6%. Defenseman numbers. And over the last three games, he's shot at zero. He hasn't scored a goal. And so what's really happened is his shooting percentage has gone way down as the season has progressed. It started out okay, which is boosting that up to 5%. It's crazy, but that's insane, right? That you need it to boost up to 5%. But over the last 15 games or so, when people have gotten really frustrated, his shooting percentage has been only 2.6%. Which is really, really low, and you wouldn't expect Phil Kessel to be there. And the overall season 5% is also really low. I'd expect on an Arizona team that normally has really low shooting percentage, Phil Kessel would actually see his shooting percentage dip a little bit from the 12.5 on the Pens to more of, let's say, probably an 8 to 10, I'd say, would be very safe assumption, especially given that he's currently at 5%. I'd expect more like an 8 to 10. I wouldn't rule out getting back up to 12. That's hard to do on an Arizona team. So I'd expect around 8 to 10 for Phil Kessel. So again, he's missing goals. Now, the interesting thing is that his expected goals for is actually almost just in line. He's missing only one goal from an expected goal standpoint, but the shooting percentage would dictate he probably should get a little bit more. But at the same time, you're talking about him playing on a very defensive line in Carl Soderberg and Lawson Krause. So probably the opportunities he's getting are not very high danger opportunities. They're more normal opportunities, which would actually bring down that expected goals for expectation. Hopefully that kind of made sense. But if you're on a more defensive team, you're not going to get as dangerous of opportunities. So your expected goals for should drop. Even if your shooting percentage should be higher, your opportunities just aren't as good. But Phil Kessel should be putting the puck in the back of the net more than he is right now. And then if we jump over to his IPP and on-ice shooting percentage, his IPP is perfect. Exactly what you'd expect right now for Phil Kessel. He's sitting at 81%. He was at 82% last year. Right in line. Perfect. What isn't perfect is his on-ice shooting percentage. It's at 6.6%. Let's round up to 7%. Last year, he was at 11% on the Pens, and this is at all strengths, including the power play. So 11% down to 6.5%. That's not good. That's really bad for Phil Kessel. And the problem there is that if you look at the last 15 days or 15 games, so the last 30 days, his shooting percent on ice shooting percentage has been 6.7%. If you look at the last three games, his on ice shooting percentage was 6%. So it's been very stable at 6% across the season. And again, that also is going to kind of make sense when you're playing on the lines that you're playing. And on top of that, he hasn't been paired with guys like Nick Schmaltz or Connor Garland, who are benefiting from high on ice shooting percentages and high shooting percentages themselves. And so when he's not benefiting from that and he's playing with guys who also have low shooting percentages, it's just not helping. And when you take into account, I took a look at Natural Stat Trick, looked at how many shots for on the ice he's been, or how many shots he's been on the ice for, that's better phrasing there, and then you factor in what his on-ice shooting percentage should be, let's assume 8 to 9%, because he's on the Arizona Coyotes. I wouldn't expect the 11% of last year with the Pens, but I would expect more like an 8 or 9% on-ice shooting with Phil Kessel on the ice, because he's actually been on the ice for third most shots for of the team. And on top of that, he has the second highest expected goals for percentage on the team. So he's been their best skater. He's been one of their best skaters. He's been fantastic. Just people aren't scoring around him. And that's really hurting him from an assist standpoint as well. Granted, you know, he has 10 assists. Last year, he got 55. So he should be on a better assist pace here. And if you take into account how many shots he's been on the ice for, what his expected on-ice shooting percentage is, and what his IPP currently is, he should have 17 points right now, not 13. It depends on how they get kind of factored in, shifted around, and whatnot. And that would put him on a 61-point pace. His team power play percentage is fine. All the other things that you kind of take a look at, he's doing fine in. He has a somewhat low power play shooting percentage. He was at 22% last year, 13% this year, but low volume so far in terms of how many shots on goal he's actually taken. It's a little tough right now to really extrapolate that. His offensive zone starts are way up from last year. Actually, not way up. His offensive zone starts are pretty much the same as last year, so he's seen similar deployment. Over the last 3 days, they've actually gone down, getting more of a defensive deployment, probably due to playing more with Soderberg and Lawson Krause, which doesn't help very much. Other than that, like, he looks pretty much like the same player. He looks like the same player as last year. The difference is he's on a worse team, a worse offensive team, I should say, with not as many offensive opportunities. And he himself is not shooting at what he should be, and players around him are underperforming. So what to expect from Phil Kessel going forward? You shouldn't expect from Phil Kessel an 82-point player. I've said that. What you should expect is more of a 60 to 70-point player. Somewhere in there, I think, is very safe to assume. Now, can he get up to those 30 goals? I don't think so. Last year, shooting at 13%, rounding up, he got 27 goals playing 82 games. I think he's going to score less of the shots that he takes this year. And so most likely you're looking at probably more of like a 22 goal score, somewhere in there, right? Like those low 20s. I think that's what you're seeing from Phil Kessel rest of season from a goal perspective. And then on the assist side, that's where you got to see it come up, and you want to see the players around him start to play better. Now, one thing that could be a little scary is, what if the players around him never get better? What if the Arizona Coyotes are inherently going to be one of the worst on-ice shooting percentage teams in the league and are going to rely on hot streaks from certain players? Or what if those hot streaks just end and the Arizona Coyotes bottom falls out and they completely rely on goaltending, similar to the New York Islanders last year? Then in that case, I think you're looking at a floor of Phil Kessel that's around 60, maybe 55 at the worst. I think at the worst, you're looking at a 55-point Phil Kessel. But I think it's more likely that you see like a 60-point Phil Kessel. 60, 65 with a 70 ceiling. I think that's kind of what I would expect from Phil Kessel, something in there. So I think what you really got to do is take a look at if that's worth it to you. If that's worth it to you and your league is deep, then I'd probably hold. If it's shallow, you can probably let go of Phil Kessel at this point. And you've probably tried to trade him and no one's biting. And part of that is, like I said, right? The shooting percentage over the last 15 games and over the last three games has been awful. It's been really, really bad. And so actually what I would say as well is I think there is going to be a time here where Phil Kessel is due some goals. And I think there's going to be a stretch where Phil Kessel finds some goals, finds some points. If you're really sick of him and do you know that a 60 to 65 point player isn't really worth much to you with not many peripherals, then in that case, what I'd do is I'd wait to sell when he gets really hot. And then I'd try to shop and see if anyone's interested, because then people are going to buy in. And Phil Kessel is definitely a guy that as soon as he has a stretch of a few good games, people are going to point to him and say, oh, he's back. That's it. Phil Kessel is going to have a huge rest of season. And then you can capitalize on that. So I'd say in shallow leagues, he's droppable. In those like middle tier leagues, like normal 12 person, even, you know, a little bit of a deeper roster 10 person, I'd probably hold for now and try to shop. In a 14 team or deeper, I'd probably hold, because again, in those leagues, a 60 point player is worth a lot more. Especially one that's going to get you those goals. Again, 22-ish goals isn't a ton, but that's going to be hard to find on the wire. Now, streamer might be more worth it. And if you're at the top of the league, what I would say too is, sorry, I know I'm kind of going off on tangents here, but the last thing I'll say is, if you're at the top of the league, guys like Phil Kessel, guys like Braden Point, guys like Blake Wheeler are much more worth holding on, because you can take on that risk. You've already been doing well. They've been doing nothing and you've been doing well. If they do really well, you're only adding to the floor of your team that's already really solid, considering how well you've been doing. If you're at the bottom, I understand you may need to shake up and you may need to start fixing things soon. And Phil Kessel may be one of your most underperforming players. In that case, what I try to do is, if you're really set on moving him, I try to trade. And if there's no buyers, then what I do is, after that, if you're set on dropping Phil Kessel, what I always advocate for is send out some offers where you're getting people who potentially got picked up on waivers, but people may drop. Like, let's say you like Horvat, right? And Horvat might be dropped soon. You could target a Horvat and say, hey, do you want Phil Kessel for Horvat? And someone would say, yeah, absolutely, because I was going to drop him anyways. But Horvat is above replacement level on your wire, if that makes sense. That's what you want to do, is if you're going to drop him and get a waiver wire player, then target just above a waiver wire player. And more likely than not, you'll get a trade done normally, because someone will see it as winning the trade. But then that way you at least get a more reliable player than whatever you were going to get on the wire. And that player can turn into a streamer and whatever. But you have a higher ceiling than a waiver player. So hopefully that helps. Phil Kessel is a very complicated situation. But I'd say that more than anything, what you have to understand with Phil Kessel is that you really, really need to adjust your expectation. He is not the player from last year. He is not going to reach the numbers he got last year unless many things change. And normally when you need to rely on many things to change, it's just not going to happen. So I don't think it's happening for Phil Kessel this year. So he's both a real bust watch and also a, you know what, could turn it around, but I don't think he's going to turn it around to the point where you say, oh my God, I'm so glad I held. So hopefully that helped. Be sure to let me know if you have any questions in the comments, maybe who you're thinking of trading them for, that kind of thing. Happy to hear from you. And also be sure to tune in to Sit Start Saturdays tomorrow morning at 11:30 Eastern. You can check it out on our channel, on our YouTube channel. You can set a reminder already if you haven't. See you tomorrow. Thanks for listening or watching. I'll catch you next time.